We read from Job 38, verses 4 through 11. Where wast thou when I laid the foundations of the earth? Declare if thou hast understanding. Who hath laid the measures thereof, if thou knowest? Or who hath stretched the line upon it? Whereupon are the foundations thereof fastened? Or who laid the cornerstone thereof? When the morning stars sang together, and all the sons of God shouted for joy. Or who shut up the sea with doors when it brake forth, as if it had issued out of the womb, when I made the cloud the garment thereof, and thick darkness a swaddling band for it, and brake up for it my decreed place, and set bars and doors, and said, Hitherto shalt thou come, but no further, and here shall thy proud waves be stayed. The expressions of this passage from Job are full of meaning for us. We understand the language here to describe the creative processes which prepared the earth for man's habitation. Verse 9 has special significance to our subject. It also reminds us of another important passage of Scripture found in Proverbs 8, verse 28. He established the clouds above. He strengthened the fountains of the deep. A careful study of these verses, together with the Genesis account, reveals to us a consistent picture of creation and the flood. We continue our reading in Genesis 7, verse 11. In the 600th year of Noah's life, in the second month, the 17th day of the month, the same day were all the fountains of the great deep broken up, and the windows of heaven were opened. This verse brings several questions to mind. What is the great deep mentioned here? We answer that this great deep is the same one mentioned in Genesis 8:2. The fountains also of the deep and the windows of heaven were stopped, and the rain from heaven was restrained. This concept is also found in Genesis 1:2. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. Based on suggestions in the harvest message, we believe that the face of the deep is the same as the face of the waters. The words fountain and deep do not accurately convey the sense of the Hebrew in this context. These English words carry with them the sense of direction. Fountains tend to go up. A deep tends to be something beneath us. However, the Genesis account is speaking of the creative processes from a much larger perspective, involving more than just our planet Earth. The terms up and down have no significance in outer space. The word fountain in the Hebrew simply signifies a source of water. The word deep is from Strong's 84:15 in the Hebrew, meaning an abyss, in the sense of a surging mass of water. This word is derived from Strong's 19:49 in the Hebrew, meaning to make an uproar, or to agitate greatly. As we look deeper into the creation account, how appropriate we find the usage of this word to be. It was the power of God moving upon the face of this surging mass of water that initiated the ordering of earth for mankind. Another question remains, where was this great deep? A careful analysis of the facts demonstrates clearly that the only possible place was beyond the atmosphere of the earth. Some have suggested that the fountains of the great deep referred to subterranean chambers filled with water. However, this would have been an impossibility on the first creative day. The earth was initially too hot to support any form of liquid water, neither on the surface nor beneath the surface. This thought is confirmed in the Photodrama of Creation, page 2. Quote, In the beginning the earth was, without form and void, shapeless, empty. There were neither mountains nor valleys, trees nor shrubs, rivers nor oceans, but the earth was. End of quotation. We read again from the Photodrama of Creation, page 16. Quote, "The fountains of the great deep, canopy, were broken up." End of quotation. This clearly shows that the term great deep refers to the canopy that enveloped the earth, lingering until the days of Noah, when the last remnants of that canopy collapsed upon the earth. The breaking up of the canopy occurred in a very literal way. We understand this was not liquid water, but frozen water. Certain natural forces caused this great ice canopy to be broken up. This process began on the first created day. Recent scientific discoveries continue to support this scriptural view of creation and the flood. Within the last few decades, a remarkable discovery has been made concerning our solar system. Billions of miles away, far beyond the orbit of Pluto, lies a mysterious object called the Oort cloud. This immense cloud is composed entirely of dirty ice. It is in fact an ice canopy, very similar to the one that originally surrounded the Earth. But how did it form? Many theories have been suggested, but scientists must confess that they do not know. Our understanding of the Genesis account suggests a reasonable theory. When the white-hot mass that constituted our solar system was in its infancy, the intense heat and combustion caused huge quantities of water vapor to be expelled into the outer regions beyond the planets. There, in the super-cold realms of empty space, this water vapor condensed into a huge ice canopy that still exists to this day. The density of this ice is such that it does not prevent our ability to see beyond to other stars and galaxies. The same concept was true before the flood of Noah's day. These ice canopies do not obstruct the view of other heavenly bodies completely. However, they do alter that view. From time to time, external forces cause disruptions in the Oort cloud, sending huge chunks of ice into an elliptical orbit around our Sun. This is the source of our long-term comets. We mention this discovery to show that the concept of an ice canopy, as taught in the Harvest Message, is supported by recent scientific discoveries. What surrounded the Earth was very similar, but on a much smaller scale. The ice canopy around Earth would have been only a short distance removed from our upper atmosphere. Returning to the creation account, we find that there were many layers within this ice canopy that fell in rapid succession. The earlier layers were composed of ice mixed with minerals and rock. These fell onto the hot surface of the Earth. The resulting chemical reactions helped produce our atmosphere. As this process continued, the surface of the Earth cooled, the Earth's crust thickened, surface water became more abundant, and continents emerged and oceans were formed. Genesis chapters 7 and 8 speak about the fountains of the great deep, the windows of heaven, and the rain. All three are different, but all three are related. When we reach Noah's day, the remaining canopy was of pure water only, in the form of ice. This was the sole remnant of the great deep. The windows of heaven were the polar channels through which the broken canopy was deposited in the form of millions of cubic miles of super cold ice. The term window is peculiar and significant. It suggests that a relatively small portal existed through which the fountains of the great deep deposited their contents. The fact that this term is plural supports the thought that both north and south polar regions were involved. The 40 days of rain was caused by the sudden extremes of hot and cold. This condition did not exist prior to the flood. As we read in Genesis 2:5, the Lord God had not caused it to rain upon the earth. From this we understand that the rain did not cause the flood, but was merely incidental to the falling of the ice canopy. This brings us to another aspect of our subject, Noah's Ark. The experience of the Apostle Thomas led to the proverb, "Seeing is believing." Truly, some things are difficult to comprehend without a visual aid. For that reason, we would like to take advantage of another aspect of the restitution blessings of computers and electronic communication. We are going to travel back to Noah's day and examine the Ark during its construction phases. The Bible is not clear as to exactly where Noah built the ark or what the surroundings were like. We have chosen a peaceful seaside setting, though in reality it is more likely that the ark was built further away from water. The fall of the canopy would have created monstrous tidal waves. Being further away from the shore would have reduced the initial impact of the first wave. Since the Bible does not give us much detailed information on the construction of the ark, what we have to offer is based on personal research, careful analysis, and deduction. A series of articles from Bible Study Monthly of England was also very helpful in forming opinions on a number of points. These thoughts are merely suggestions. Our purpose is to demonstrate that such a project was feasible and practical. It matters little if other methods were used. We only wish to show one possible method in order to vindicate the Genesis account and to give an answer to higher critics. With such an immense construction project as this, the first task for Noah and his sons would probably have been the preparation of the site itself. Just as it was necessary to prepare the platform level before the construction of the Great Pyramid could begin, so too we believe the same was done before construction began on Noah's Ark. In fact, we believe that many of the same principles used in constructing the Great Pyramid may very well have been learned by Shem when he was assisting in the construction of the Ark. We will discuss some other connections between the Great Pyramid and Noah's Ark as we proceed through this lesson. To begin the project, a large rectangular area would have been cleared and leveled. It is likely that the base of the ark was built first. Waterproofing material would have been applied to the underside as the floor was constructed. A beveled retaining wall with corner sockets like the Great Pyramid may have been used around the perimeter of the base. This would have served several purposes. Most importantly, it would have relieved stress on the joinings of the sides and base created by the weight of the structure. Incidentally, such stresses would not have existed once the ark was afloat. Such a perimeter wall would have also defined the dimensions of the ark before construction even began, thus providing a useful project boundary. Construction materials would have been gathered, finished, and stored until needed. This phase could have commenced many years or even decades before construction itself began. It is important to remember the conditions that existed before the flood. The entire planet was bathed in tropical warmth due to the hothouse conditions under the canopy. Plant growth was much larger and more uniform than at present. Finding the huge trees necessary for the beams and crossbeams of the ark would have been a much easier task than today. Preservation of the wood itself was of less consequence, since the processes which cause fermentation and other similar forms of decay did not exist before the flood. Just as God instructed Moses in the building of the tabernacle and Shem in the construction of the Great Pyramid, we believe he also instructed Noah in the techniques necessary for constructing the ark. The task of cutting, finishing, transporting, and finally raising huge beams into place would have been a much simpler task than was necessary to construct the Great Pyramid. The use of simple mechanisms such as levers, ropes, pulleys, and ramps would have been adequate for Noah's Ark. The Great Pyramid was most likely constructed during a period of 30 years, between 2170 BC and 2140 BC. The suggestion drawn from Genesis 6:3 that God told Noah to build the ark 120 years before the flood seems like a reasonable inference. However, this would have been before his sons were born. Nevertheless, from other indications, Noah was probably a wealthy and influential man, and may have used his wealth and influence in gathering and preparing materials before Ham, Shem, and Japheth were old enough to assist. The Genesis account suggests that the structure of the ark was nothing like a conventional boat. This is certainly reasonable, since few of the traditional uses of boats apply to the ark. Its main function was to transport cargo, and the most precious cargo at that. No motive power was necessary. No steering mechanism was required. No sleek design was needed to speed the ark through ocean waters. It merely had to drift with the current. All these factors and others prove conclusively that the shape of the ark was that of a huge flat-bottom boat. Furthermore, based on our understanding of all the facts, the shape shown here is the one most in accord with the Bible, with reason, and with scientific principles. The size of the ark is given in Genesis 6:15. The length of the ark shall be 300 cubits, the breadth of it 50 cubits, and the height of it 30 cubits. There is a great deal of uncertainty in respect to the length of the cubit used. Several measures have been proposed. 18 inches is the size of the sacred cubit. The royal cubit of Egypt was between 20.6 and 21.6 inches. The pyramid cubit is roughly 25 inches. Each of these measures has arguments in favor of its use. Using the sacred cubit would have resulted in a size of 450 feet long by 45 feet high by 75 feet wide at the base. If the royal cubit of 21.6 inches was used, the size of the ark would have been 540 feet long by 54 feet high by 90 feet wide at the base. The largest dimensions would arise from using the pyramid cubit, 625 feet long by 62.5 feet high by approximately 104 feet wide at the base. Assyrian records show a length for the ark of 540 feet. The smallest of these systems of measurement would still have resulted in a vessel sufficiently large to fulfill its mission. If we use the sacred cubit, then the timbers used in constructing this model would correspond to a size of 24 inches by 24 inches. The length of the longest timber would have been 75 feet. As stated before, trees with such dimensions would have been more plentiful in Noah's day than now. There was also the possibility of fabricating larger beams from a series of smaller ones. Two working models of Noah's Ark with the same design shown here have been constructed in the past. The largest, 120 feet long, was constructed in Holland by one Peter Jansen in the year 1609. It was used commercially for a time, but was abandoned due to the difficulty in arranging for motive power. The other was strictly a model, built by a naval architect named Vogt in 1904. It had a length of 30 feet. In both cases, the most remarkable feature of this design was the extreme seaworthiness of the craft, even in the roughest of seas. We are standing on the deck of the middle floor of Noah's Ark. From here, we can begin to see and appreciate the immense size and capacity of this vessel. Behind me, nearly 2 football fields distant, almost 600 feet away, is the other end of the ark. The height from floor to ceiling here is over 16 feet, and the distance from one edge of the floor to the other at this level was 60 feet. This would provide a square foot capacity of over 30,000. But that does not begin to tell the story, because items could have been stored in a stacked fashion from floor to ceiling, providing an immense cubic capacity. This area, we believe, was used as a storage place for food and other necessaries that would be required during the journey. Once the outer surface of the ark was in place, this area would have been in total darkness. When Noah and his sons made their daily journeys here to take items to the top floor, some form of artificial illumination would have been necessary, such as torches or other things. For that reason, we believe that animals and humans did not reside in this part of the ark. We believe that only the top floor was suitable as living quarters. A system of ramps or stairs would have been necessary to give access between floors during the journey. We're still standing on the second or middle floor of the ark. What we'll be looking at is given merely in the way of a suggestion, but some similar concept would have been necessary. This longer ramp is less steep and would have been more practical for regular use. It joins this second floor to the top and would have been used by Noah and his sons on a daily basis to carry food and other materials from here up to the top floor. These shorter ramps are more steep. They join this second middle floor to the bottom. These would not have been used on a regular basis. They would have only been used in case of an emergency. It's important to remember the purpose of the bottom floor. It served as a warehouse to store materials that would have been used by Noah and his family after the ark landed on the mountains of Ararat. There is a rather obscure phrase in Genesis 6:16, "In a cubit shalt thou finish it above." The cuneiform sign for cubit and the primitive pictograph which preceded it in the days of Eber and Peleg suggests an angle. And this expression, "finished in a cubit above," might well denote what we call the apex, the angle at the top of the ark formed by the meeting of the two sloping sides, much as we might say it finished in an inverted V at the top. It was at this apex of the roof that a small aperture existed to allow fresh air to enter and to circulate. These and all openings of the ark were sealed when it was overwhelmed by the first wave. We're now on the bottom floor of the Ark, and you'll notice behind me there's one of the short steep ramps that goes up to the second level. As mentioned before, this would not have been used only rarely during the journey, but it might have been much more useful during the construction phases and during the period when materials were being loaded upon the Ark. The purpose of this lowest level was a kind of a warehouse to store materials that would have been used primarily after the flood, after the Ark landed on the mountains of Ararat. We believe that those materials could have been placed here a long time before the flood. In fact, it would have been most practical if they could have been brought in before the outer surface of the Ark was actually put in place. There is a sort of a pathway that you'll notice here in front of us, and this pathway would have been useful to use large wheeled carts for moving materials from the outside as they came in and then to take them to their respective locations. It is a massive area here, over 50,000 square feet, and we'll be looking at it more here in just a moment. This particular view of the bottom floor of the Ark is looking in from the side, the longest dimension being to my left and right, a distance of over 500 feet, nearly 2 football fields in length. But the distance across the floor here from edge to edge was also immense, 90 feet. It's by taking these dimensions that we come up with the figure of more than 50,000 square feet of floor space. But it is important to remember that materials could have been stacked from floor to ceiling, a distance of more than 16 feet, thus providing a huge area for cargo. These materials were items that were being stored for use primarily after the Ark landed on the mountains of Ararat. You'll notice behind me is the pathway we referred to earlier that could have been used by the large wheeled carts to move materials into place. Also in front of me on the floor, you'll notice there is kind of a ribbed effect here. These beams would have served at least two purposes. One of them would have been to reinforce the structure of the Ark itself, but the other purpose would have been to help to keep materials in place during rough seas. Crates or some other form of box could have been constructed by Noah and his sons in which to place materials, and they could have been so constructed as to fit neatly into these areas, and thus perhaps even interlocking would have been very rigid during transit. We are still on the bottom floor of the Ark at one of the two ends. And you'll notice the wall here that is next to me. This wall is a sort of a bulkhead arrangement. It is formed by one of the walls of the four large tanks that we looked at earlier. We're actually going to go inside one of these tanks and look at it in a few moments. The tanks at the end would have provided a sort of structural support, and it was the ends where structural support was most needed. But also materials could have been stacked against these walls here on the bottom floor. We're now inside one of the four large tanks that we referred to earlier. The only way of getting in and out of here right now is this ladder behind me. Of course, once the Ark was completed, and before the journey began, we think that two of these tanks were probably filled with fresh water for drinking, and the other two tanks were used for disposing of waste material during the journey. This large pillar on my right is an example of one of the largest beams that would have been necessary for the structure of the Ark. And depending on which dimensions of the Ark we choose, this beam would have been 24 inches by 24 inches, or it could have been as much as 30 inches by 30 inches, depending on what size of the cubit that we use. We are now on the top or third floor of Noah's Ark. Though this was the smallest in area, it is by far the most important. It is here that Noah, his family, and all of the animals resided for a period of approximately 1 year. Though it is the smallest of the three, it is still a very large area. The distance from side to side here is 30 feet across the floor. And likewise from end to end, over 500 feet, even at this level. Thus, the number of square feet of floor space was over 15,000. But it is the cubic capacity which is most significant. With a height from floor to ceiling of over 16 feet, the cubic capacity would have been more than 120,000. And we believe that this would have been sufficient for living quarters for Noah, his family, and all of the animals. In this section of the ark, we have some examples of smaller living quarters that would have been more common for the varieties of air-breathing animals found on the ark. We'd like to thank our assistants here today, both of them. It's important to remember that the average size of an adult air-breathing animal is that of a common house cat. The Genesis account does not give many details on how the animal's living spaces were constructed. So what we have to offer here again is merely in the way of a suggestion. It's important to remember that there were very few large animals such as horses or cows on Noah's Ark. And for those that were larger, it is possible, likely, that a traditional arrangement was constructed, such as what we see here. It is estimated that all living varieties of breathing animals sprang from approximately 25,000 different species. If we make a liberal estimate of both the clean and the unclean animals that were on board the ark, the total number of animals would have been something more than 50,000 and something less than 60,000. For sake of argument, let's assume the higher number of 60,000. Taking that with the estimated cubic capacity of this section of the ark of 120,000 cubic feet, this would have provided an average living space for each of the animals of 2 cubic feet. We're going to go down the hallway here and look at some examples of other kinds of living quarters for some of the smaller animals. We read in Genesis 6:14, "Make thee an ark of gopher wood. Rooms shalt thou make in the ark, and shalt pitch it within and without with pitch." The word translated rooms here really means nests in the Hebrew. The height of this section would have allowed for many nests or other compartments for the animals stacked from floor to ceiling. The size of the compartment shown here is about 2 cubic feet. This was chosen for illustrative purposes, since it is the average amount of living space that would have been available for each animal. The house cat shown here is the size of an average air-breathing animal. The amount of space allotted seems quite adequate. In addition, if the animals taken on board the ark were not mature adults, then the average size would have been even smaller. One other factor is worthy of consideration in respect to the animals. Many animals go into a state of hibernation in the wintertime. Other species have been known to go into a similar state of relative dormancy under severe circumstances. Since darkness would have been the normal condition, even on the top floor, it is possible that many, if not all, the animals went into such a state of suspended animation. This would have solved many logistical problems. It would have significantly reduced the demands on 8 people to feed 60,000 animals and to dispose of their waste. It would also have reduced the amount of food and water necessary on board. Regardless of what methods the Lord chose, The main point of our analysis and conclusions is that such a project was both possible and practical. Several comments have been made about the need for structural support and integrity in the construction of the ark. It was mentioned that the four tanks at opposite ends of the ark provide much needed support. Other comments have been made concerning the huge beams used throughout the framework. From an architectural standpoint, the strongest geometric shape used in construction is the triangle. The strongest three-dimensional shape used in construction is that of the pyramid. For example, a common gabled roof is in the shape of a pyramid. This shape is evident in our model of Noah's Ark as well. The need for structural support was especially important when the floodwaters initially overwhelmed the ark. As mentioned before, the waters of the canopy descended at the poles and rushed toward the equator in the form of huge tidal waves. When these waves first reached the ark, the initial impact was tremendous. A conventional boat would not have survived. A flat-bottom boat in the shape of a large box would also not have survived such an impact. It is only the pyramid shape, as shown in this model, that is suited for all the circumstances related to us in the Bible and in the harvest message. We are reminded of two important passages of Scripture. And God said, "Let there be a firmament, atmosphere, in the midst of the waters, and let it divide the waters from the waters. And God made the firmament, and divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament. And it was so." Genesis 1, 6 and 7. By the intention of God, the skies existed from of old, and the earth with water above and water below, arranged for the purpose of God, by means of which the then existing world perished by the water having rushed down. 2 Peter 3, 5 and 6 for R. Fenton's translation.
Noah was a man of faith, and he believed God and acted out that belief in carrying out a command that must have seemed utterly fantastic to all who heard of it. And the greatest test of faith must have been at the moment when, with all his 20,000 tons of stores and goods and animals stowed safely inside, Noah and his family climbed into the giant vessel which they had built. They heard the door close heavily upon them and shut them away completely from the outside world, and sat down in the darkness to wait. Noah and his family sat inside the ark, counting 7 slow days from the 10th day of the 2nd month until the 17th day, waiting for the fulfillment of God's word and the coming of divine judgment. So our thoughts come back to those 8 persons of faith, the only ones in all the world who believed God, shut up inside the only possible haven of refuge from the wrath to come, surrounded by a heedless and scornful world which went on with its daily interests, unbelieving, ignorant. And far to the south of that land, with its shining cities, away at the other end of the southern ocean which they had probably never even explored, there rushed towards them the angel of vengeance, which was to sweep their land with the besom of destruction and leave God's world ready for a fresh start.